The Early Christian Writings of Justin Martyr. By Justin the Philosopher. Podcast 10 of 22. Part 5. Justin Martyr's Dialogue with Trypho, a Judaeagogue. Continues. Chapter 38. Christ is to be adored. And Trypho said, Sir, it were good for us if we obeyed our teachers, who laid down a law that we should have no intercourse with any of you, and that we should not have even any communication with you on these questions. For you utter many blasphemies, in that you seek to persuade us that this crucified man was with Moses and Aaron, and spoke to them in the pillar of the cloud, then that he became man, was crucified, and ascended up to heaven, and comes again to earth, and ought to be worshipped. Then I answered, I know that, as the word of God says, this great wisdom of God, the maker of all things, and the Almighty, is hid from you. Wherefore, in sympathy with you, I am striving to the utmost that you may understand these matters which to you are paradoxical, but if not, that I myself may be innocent in the day of judgment. For you shall hear other words which appear still more paradoxical, but be not confounded, nay, rather remain still more zealous hearers and investigators, despising the tradition of your teachers, since they are convicted by the Holy Spirit of inability to perceive the truths taught by God, and of preferring to teach their own doctrines. Accordingly, in the 45th Psalm, these words are in like manner referred to Christ, My heart has brought forth a good matter, I tell my works to the King. My tongue is the pen of a ready writer. Fairer in beauty than the sons of men, grace is poured forth into thy lips, therefore bath God bless thee forever. Gird thy sword upon thy thigh, O mighty one. Press on in thy fairness and in thy beauty, and prosper and reign, because of truth, and of meekness, and of righteousness, and thy right hand shall instruct thee marvelously. Thine arrows are sharpened, O mighty one, the people shall fall under thee, in the heart of the enemies of the king. Thy throne, O God, is forever and ever, a scepter of equity is the scepter of thy kingdom. Thou hast loved righteousness, and hast hated iniquity, therefore thy God hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy fellows, with myrrh and oil and cassia, from thy garments, from the ivory palaces, whereby they made thee glad. King's daughters are in thy honor. The queen stood at thy right hand, clad in garments embroidered with gold. Hearken, O daughter, and behold, and incline thine ear, and forget thy people and the house of thy father, and the king shall desire thy beauty, because he is thy lord, they shall worship him also. And the daughter of Tyre with gifts, the rich of the people shall entreat thy face. All the glory of the king's daughter within, clad in embroidered garments of needlework. The virgins that follow her shall be brought to the king, her neighbors shall be brought unto thee, they shall be brought with joy and gladness, they shall be led into the king's shrine. Instead of thy fathers, thy sons have been born, thou shalt appoint them rulers over all the earth. I shall remember thy name in every generation, therefore the people shall confess thee forever, and forever and ever. Chapter 39. Christians believe in the Son of God. Now it is not surprising, I continued, that you hate us who hold these opinions, and convict you of a continual hardness of heart. For indeed Elijah, conversing with God concerning you, speaks thus, Lord, they have slain thy prophets, and digged down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. And he answers him, I have still 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to Baal. Therefore, just as God did not inflict his anger on account of those 7,000 men, even so he has now neither yet inflicted judgment, nor does inflict it, knowing that daily some are becoming disciples in the name of Christ, and quitting the path of error, who are also receiving gifts, each as he is worthy, illumined through the name of this Christ. For one receives the spirit of understanding, another of counsel, another of strength, another of healing, another of foreknowledge, another of teaching, and another of the fear of God. To this Trypho said to me, I wish you knew that you are beside yourself, talking these sentiments. And I said to him, Listen, O friend, for I am not mad or beside myself, but it was prophesied that, After the ascent of Christ to heaven, he would deliver us from error and give us gifts. The words are these: he ascended up on high, he led captivity captive, he gave gifts to men. Accordingly, we who have received gifts from Christ, who has ascended up on high, prove from the words of prophecy that you, the wise in yourselves, and the men of understanding in your own eyes, are foolish, and honor God and his Christ by lip only. But we, who are instructed in the whole truth, honor them both in acts, and in knowledge, and in heart, even unto death. But you hesitate to confess that he is Christ, as the scriptures and the events witnessed and done in his name prove, perhaps for this reason, lest you be persecuted by the rulers, who, under the influence of the wicked and deceitful spirit, the serpent, will not cease putting to death and persecuting those who confess the name of Christ until he come again, and destroy them all, and render to each his deserts. And Trypho replied, Now, then, render us the proof that this man who you say was crucified and ascended into heaven is the Christ of God. For you have sufficiently proved by means of the scriptures previously quoted by you, that it is declared in the scriptures that Christ must suffer, and come again with glory, and receive the eternal kingdom over all the nations, every kingdom being made subject to him. Now show us that this man is he. And I replied, It has been already proved, sirs, to those who have ears, even from the facts which have been conceded by you, but that you may not think me at a loss, and unable to give proof of what you ask, as I promised, I shall do so at a fitting place. At present, I resume the consideration of the subject which I was discussing. Chapter 40 The Mosaic Laws pertain to Christ's identity. The mystery, then, of the Lamb which God enjoined to be sacrificed as the Passover, was a type of Christ, with whose blood, in proportion to their faith in him, they anoint their houses, who believe on him. For that the creation which God created to wit, Adam was a house for the Spirit which proceeded from God, you all can understand. And that this injunction was temporary, I prove thus. God does not permit the Lamb of the Passover to be sacrificed in any other place than where his name was named, knowing that the days will come, after the suffering of Christ, when even the place in Jerusalem shall be given over to your enemies, and all the offerings, in short, shall cease, and that lamb which was commanded to be wholly roasted was a symbol of the suffering of the cross which Christ would undergo. For the lamb, which is roasted and dressed up in the form of the cross. For one spit is transfixed right through from the lower parts up to the head, and one across the back, to which are attached the legs of the lamb. And the two goats which were ordered to be offered during the fast, of which one was sent away as the scapegoat, and the other sacrificed, were similarly declarative of the two appearances of Christ, the first, in which the elders of your people, and the priests, having laid hands on him and put him to death, sent him away as the scapegoat, and his second appearance, because in the same place in Jerusalem you shall recognize him whom you have disinured, and who was an offering for all sinners. Willing to repent, and keeping the fast which Isaiah speaks of, loosening the terms of the violent contracts, and keeping the other precepts, likewise enumerated by him, and which I have quoted, which those believing in Jesus do. And further, you are aware that the offering of the two goats, which were enjoined to be sacrificed at the fast, was not permitted to take place similarly anywhere else, but only in Jerusalem. Chapter 41 The oblation of fine flour is a type of the Eucharist. And the offering of fine flour, sirs, I said, which was prescribed to be presented on behalf of those purified from leprosy, was a type of the bread of the Eucharist, the celebration of which our Lord Jesus Christ prescribed, in remembrance of the suffering which he endured on behalf of those who are purified in soul from all iniquity, in order that we may at the same time thank God for having created the world, with all things therein, for the sake of man, and for delivering us from the evil in which we were, and for utterly overthrowing principalities and powers by him who suffered according to his will. Hence God speaks by the mouth of Malachi, one of the 12, as I said before, about the sacrifices at that time presented by you, I have no pleasure in you, saith the Lord, and I will not accept your sacrifices at your hands, For, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, my name has been glorified among the Gentiles, and in every place incense is offered to my name, and a pure offering, for my name is great among the Gentiles, saith the Lord, but ye profane it. He then speaks of those Gentiles, namely us, who in every place offer sacrifices to him, the bread of the Eucharist, and also the cup of the Eucharist, affirming both that we glorify his name, and that you profane. The command of circumcision, again, bidding always circumcise the children on the eighth day, was a type of the true circumcision, by which we are circumcised from deceit and iniquity through him who rose from the dead on the first day after the Sabbath, our Lord Jesus Christ. For the first day after the Sabbath, remaining the first of all the days, is called, however, the eighth, according to the number of all the days of the cycle, and remains the first. Chapter 42. The bells on the priest's robe are a type of the apostles. Moreover, the prescription that 12 bells be attached to the robe of the high priest, which hung down to the feet, was a symbol of the 12 apostles, who depend on the power of Christ, the eternal priest, and through their voice it is that all the earth has been filled with the glory and grace of God and of his Christ. Wherefore David also says, their sound has gone forth into all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. And Isaiah speaks as if he were personating the apostles, when they say to Christ that they believe not in their own report, but in the power of him who sent them. And so he says, Lord, who hath believed our report, and to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? We have preached before him as if a child, as if a root in a dry ground. And what follows in order of the prophecy already quoted? But when the passage speaks as from the lips of many, we have preached before him, and adds, as if a child, it signifies that the wicked shall become subject to him, and shall obey his command, and that all shall become as one child. Such a thing as you may witness in the body, although the members are enumerated as many, all are called one, and are a body. For, indeed, a commonwealth and a church, though many individuals in number, are in fact as one, called and addressed by one appellation. And in short, sirs, said I, by enumerating all the other appointments of Moses I can demonstrate that they were types, and symbols, and declarations of those things which would happen to Christ, of those who it was foreknown were to believe in him, and of those things which would also be done by Christ himself. But since what I have now enumerated appears to me to be sufficient, I revert again to the order of the discourse. Chapter 43. The law had an end in Christ, who was born of a virgin. As, then, circumcision began with Abraham, and the Sabbath and sacrifices and offerings and feasts with Moses, and it has been proved they were enjoined on account of the hardness of your people's heart, so it was necessary, in accordance with the Father's will, that they should have an end in him who was born of a virgin, of the family of Abraham and tribe of Judah, and of David, in Christ the Son of God, who was proclaimed as about to come to all the world, to be the everlasting law and the everlasting covenant, even as the forementioned prophecies show. And we, who have approached God through him, have received not carnal, but spiritual circumcision, which Enoch and those like him observed. And we have received it through baptism, since we were sinners, by God's mercy, and all men may equally obtain it. But since the mystery of his birth now demands our attention, I shall speak of it. Isaiah then asserted in regard to the generation of Christ, that it could not be declared by man, in words already quoted, who shall declare his generation, for his life is taken from the earth, for the transgressions of my people was he led to death. The spirit of prophecy thus affirmed that the generation of him who was to die, that we sinful men might be healed by his stripes, was such as could not be declared. Furthermore, that the men who believe in him may possess the knowledge of the manner in which he came into the world, the spirit of prophecy by the same Isaiah foretold how it would happen thus, and the Lord spoke again to Ahaz, saying, ask for thyself a sign from the Lord thy God, in the depth, or in the height. And Ahaz said, I will not ask, neither will I tempt the Lord. And Isaiah said, hear then, O house of David, is it a small thing for you to contend with men, And how do you contend with the Lord? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive, and shall bear a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel. Butter and honey shall he eat, before he knows or prefers the evil, and chooses out the good, for before the child knows good or ill, he rejects evil by choosing out the good. For before the child knows how to call father or mother, he shall receive the power of Damascus and the spoil of Samaria in presence of the king of Assyria. And the land shall be forsaken, which thou shalt with difficulty endure in consequence of the presence of its two kings. But God shall bring on thee, and on thy people, and on the house of thy father, days which have not yet come upon thee since the day in which Ephraim took away from Judah the king of Assyria. Now it is evident to all, that in the race of Abraham according to the flesh no one has been born of a virgin, or is said to have been born, save this our Christ. But since you and your teachers venture to affirm that in the prophecy of Isaiah it is not said, Behold, the virgin shall conceive, but, Behold, the young woman shall conceive, and bear a son, and you explain the prophecy as if to Hezekiah, who was your king, I shall endeavor to this point in opposition to you, and to show that reference is made to him who is acknowledged by us as Christ. Chapter 44 Salvation is obtained in Christ's love. For thus, so far as you are concerned, I shall be found in all respects innocent, if I strive earnestly to persuade you by bringing forward demonstrations. But if you remain hard-hearted, or weak in a resolution, on account of death, which is the lot of the Christians, and are unwilling to assent to the truth, you shall appear as the authors of your own. And you deceive yourselves while you fancy that, because you are the seed of Abraham after the flesh, therefore you shall fully inherit the good things announced to be bestowed by God through Christ. For no one, not even of them, has anything to look for, but only those who in mind are assimilated to the faith of Abraham, and who have recognized all the mysteries, for I say, that some injunctions were laid on you in reference to the worship of God and practice of righteousness, but some injunctions and acts were likewise mentioned in reference to the mystery of Christ, on account of the hardness of your people's hearts. And that this is so, God makes known in Ezekiel, he said concerning it, if Noah and Jacob and Daniel should beg either sons or daughters, the request would not be granted them. And in Isaiah, of the very same matter he spake thus, the Lord God said, They shall both go forth and look on the members of the men that have transgressed. For their worm shall not die, and their fire shall not be quenched, and they shall be a gazing stock to all flesh. So that it becomes you to eradicate this hope from your souls, and hasten to know in what way forgiveness of sins, and a hope of inheriting the promised good things, shall be yours. But there is no other than this, to become acquainted with this Christ, to be washed in the fountain spoken of by Isaiah for the remission of sins, and for the rest, to live sinless lives. Chapter 45 Those who were righteous before and under the law are saved by Christ. And Trypho said, If I seem to interrupt these matters, which you say must be investigated, yet the question which I mean to put is urgent. Suffer me first. And I replied, Ask whatever you please, as it occurs to you, and I shall endeavor, after questions and answers, to resume and complete the discourse. Then he said, Tell me, then, shall those who lived according to the law given by Moses, live in the same manner with Jacob, Enoch, and Noah, in the resurrection of the dead, or not? I replied to him, when I quoted, Sir, the words spoken by Ezekiel, that even if Noah and Daniel and Jacob were to beg sons and daughters, the request would not be granted them, but that each one, that is to say, shall be saved by his own righteousness, I said also, that those who regulated their lives by the law of Moses would in like manner be saved. For what in the law of Moses is naturally good, and pious, and righteous, and has been prescribed to be done by those who obey it, and what was appointed to be performed by reason of the hardness of the people's hearts, was similarly recorded, and done also by those who were under the law. Since those who did that which is universally, naturally, and eternally good are pleasing to God, they shall be saved through this Christ in the resurrection equally with those righteous men who were before them, namely Noah, and Enoch, and Jacob, and whoever else there be, along with those who have known this Christ, Son of God, who was before the morning star and the moon, and submitted to become incarnate, and be born of this virgin of the family of David, in order that, by this dispensation, the serpent that sinned from the beginning, and the angels like him, may be destroyed, and that death may be contemned, and forever quit, at the second coming of the Christ himself, those who believe in him and live acceptably, and be no more, when some are sent to be punished unceasingly into judgment and condemnation of fire, but others shall exist in freedom from suffering, from corruption, and from grief, and in immortality. Chapter 46 Trypho asks whether a man who blindly keeps the law will be saved. But if some, even now, wish to live in the observance of the institutions given by Moses, and yet believe in this Jesus who was crucified, recognizing him to be the Christ of God, and that it is given to him to be absolute judge of all, and that his is the everlasting kingdom, can they also be saved? He inquired of me. And I replied, Let us consider that also together, whether one may now observe all the Mosaic institutions. And he answered, No. For we know that, as you said, it is not possible either anywhere to sacrifice the lamb of the Passover, or to offer the goats ordered for the fast, or, in short, all the other offerings. And I said, Tell then yourself, I pray, some things which can be observed, for you will be persuaded that, though a man does not keep or has not performed the eternal decrees, he may assuredly be saved. Then he replied, To keep the Sabbath, to be circumcised, to observe months, and to be washed if you touch anything prohibited by Moses, or after sexual intercourse. And I said, Do you think that Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Noah, and Job, and all the rest before or after them equally righteous, also Sarah the wife of Abraham, Rebekah the wife of Isaac, Rachel the wife of Jacob, and Leah, and all the rest of them, until the mother of Moses the faithful servant, who observed none of these, will be saved? And Trypho answered, Were not Abraham and his descendants circumcised? And I said, I know that Abraham and his descendants were circumcised. The reason why circumcision was given to them I stated at length in what has gone before, and if what has been said does not convince you, let us again search into the matter. But you are aware that, up to Moses, no one in fact who was righteous observed any of these rites at all of which we are talking, or received one commandment to observe, except that of circumcision, which began from Abraham. And he replied, We know it, and admit that they are saved. Then I returned answer, You perceive that God by Moses laid all such ordinances upon you on account of the hardness of your people's hearts, in order that, by the large number of them, you might keep God continually, and in every action, before your eyes, and never begin to act unjustly or impiously. For he enjoined you to place around you a purple dye, in order that you might not forget God, and he commanded you to wear a phylactery, certain characters, which indeed we consider holy, being engraved on very thin parchment, and by these means stirring you up to retain a constant remembrance of God, at the same time, however, convincing you, that in your hearts you have not even a faint remembrance of God's worship. Yet not even so were you dissuaded from idolatry, for in the times of Elijah, when recounted the number of those who had not bowed the knee to Baal, he said the number was 7,000, and in Isaiah he rebukes you for having sacrificed your children to idols. But we, because we refuse to sacrifice to those to whom we were of old accustomed to sacrifice, undergo extreme penalties, and rejoice in death, believing that God will raise us up by his Christ, and will make us incorruptible, and undisturbed, and immortal, and we know that the ordinances imposed by reason of the hardness of your people's hearts, contribute nothing to the performance of righteousness and of piety. Chapter 47 On Christians Who Observe the Law. And Trypho again inquired, But if someone, knowing that this is so, after he recognizes that this man is Christ, and has believed in and obeys him, wishes, however, to observe these, will he be saved? I said, In my opinion, Trypho, such an one will be saved, if he does not strive in every way to persuade other men, I mean those Gentiles who have been circumcised from error by Christ, to observe the same things as himself, telling them that they will not be saved unless they do so. This you did yourself at the commencement of the discourse, when you declared that I would not be saved unless I observe these institutions. Then he replied, Why then have you said, In my opinion, such an one will be saved, unless there are some who affirm that such will not be saved? There are such people, Trypho, I answered, and these do not venture to have any intercourse with or to extend hospitality to such persons, but I do not agree with them. But if some, through weak-mindedness, wish to observe such institutions as were given by Moses, from which they expect some virtue, but which we believe were appointed by reason of the hardness of the people's hearts, along with their hope in this Christ, and the eternal and natural acts of righteousness and piety, yet choose to live with the Christians and the faithful, as I said before, not inducing them either to be circumcised like themselves, or to keep the Sabbath, or to observe any other such ceremonies, then I hold that we ought to join ourselves to such, and associate with them in all things as kinsmen and brethren. But if, Trypho, I continued, some of your race, who say they believe in this Christ, compel those Gentiles who believe in this Christ to live in all respects according to the law given by Moses, or choose not to associate so intimately with them, I in like manner do not approve of them. But I believe that even those, who have been persuaded by them to observe the legal dispensation along with their confession of God in Christ, shall probably be saved. And I hold, further, that such as have confessed and known this man to be Christ, yet who have gone back from some cause to the legal dispensation, and have denied that this man is Christ, and have repented not before death, shall by no means be saved. Further, I hold that those of the seed of Abraham who live according to the law, and do not believe in this Christ before death, shall likewise not be saved, and especially those who have anathematized and do anathematize this very Christ in the synagogues, and everything by which they might obtain salvation and escape the vengeance of fire. For the goodness and the loving kindness of God, and his boundless riches, hold righteous and sinless the man who, as Ezekiel tells, repents of sins, and reckons sinful, unrighteous, and impious the man who fails away from piety and righteousness to unrighteousness and ungodliness. Wherefore also our Lord Jesus Christ said, In whatsoever things I shall take you, in these I shall judge you. Chapter 48 That Jesus of Nazareth is Christ. And Trypho said, We have heard what you think of these matters. Resume the discourse where you left off, and bring it to an end. For some of it appears to me to be paradoxical, and wholly incapable of proof. For when you say that this Christ existed as God before the ages, then that he submitted to be born and become man, yet that he is not man of man, this appears to me to be not merely paradoxical, but also foolish. And I replied to this, I know that the statement does appear to be paradoxical, especially to those of your race, who are ever unwilling to understand or to perform of God, but those of your teachers, as God himself declares. Now assuredly, Trypho, I continued, that this man is the Christ of God does not fail, though I be unable to prove that he existed formerly as Son of the Maker of all things, being God, and was born a man by the Virgin. But since I have certainly proved that this man is the Christ of God, whoever he be, even if I do not prove that he pre-existed, and submitted to be born a man of like passions with us, having a body, according to the Father's will, in this last matter alone is it just to say that I have erred, and not to deny that he is the Christ, though it should appear that he was born man of men, and is proved, that he has become Christ by election. For there are some, my friends, I said, of our race, who admit that he is Christ, while holding him to be man of men, with whom I do not agree, nor would I, even though most of those who have the same opinions as myself should say so, since we were enjoined by Christ himself to put no faith in human doctrines, but in those proclaimed by the blessed prophets and taught by himself. Chapter 49 On the Sign of Elijah. And Trypho said, Those who affirm him to have been a man, and to have been anointed by election, and then to have become Christ, appear to me to speak more plausibly than you who hold those opinions which you express. For we all expect that Christ will be a man of men, and that Elijah when he comes will anoint him. But if this man appear to be Christ, he must certainly be known as man of men, but from the circumstance that Elijah has not yet come, I infer that this man is not he. Then I inquired of him, Does not Scripture, in the book of Zechariah, say that Elijah shall come before the great and terrible day of the Lord? And he answered, Certainly. If therefore Scripture compels you to admit that two advents of Christ were predicted to take place, one in which he would appear suffering and disfigured and without comeliness, but the other in which he would come glorious and judge of all, as has been made manifest in many of the foresighted passages, shall we not suppose that the word of God has proclaimed that Elijah shall be the precursor of the great and terrible day, that is, of his second advent? Certainly, he answered. And, accordingly, our Lord in his teaching, I continued, proclaimed that this very thing would take place, saying that Elijah would also come. And we know that this shall take place when our Lord Jesus Christ shall come in glory from heaven, whose first manifestation the Spirit of God who was in Elijah preceded as herald in John, a prophet among your nation, after whom no other prophet appeared among you. He cried, as he sat by the river Jordan, I baptize you with water to repentance, but he that is stronger than I shall come, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear, he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire, whose fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly purge his floor, and will gather the wheat into the barn, but the chaff he will burn up with unquenchable fire. And this very prophet your King Herod had shut up in prison, and when his birthday was celebrated, and the niece of the same Herod by her dancing had pleased him, he told her to ask whatever she pleased. Then the mother of the maiden instigated her to ask the head of John, who was in prison, and having asked it, sent and ordered the head of John to be brought in on a charger. Wherefore also our Christ said, On earth, to those who were affirming that Elijah must come before Christ, Elijah shall come, and restore all things, but I say unto you, that Elijah has already come, and they knew him not, but have done to him whatsoever they chose. And it is written, Then the disciples understood that he spake to them about John the Baptist. And Trypho said, This statement also seems to me paradoxical, namely, that the prophetic Spirit of God, who was in Elijah, was also in John. To this I replied, Do you not think that the same thing happened in the case of Joshua the son of Nun, who succeeded to the command of the people after Moses, when Moses was commanded to lay his hands on Joshua, and God said to him, I will take of the Spirit which is in thee, and put it on him. And he said, Certainly. As therefore, I say, while Moses was still among men, God took of the Spirit which was in Moses and put it on Joshua, even so God was able to cause of Elijah to come upon John. In order that, as Christ at his first coming appeared in glorious, even so the first coming of the Spirit, which remained always pure in Elijah's like that of Christ, might be perceived to be in glorious. For the Lord said he would wage war against Amalek with concealed hand, and you will not deny that Amalek fell. But if it is said that only in the glorious advent of Christ war will be waged with Amalek, how great will the fulfillment of Scripture be which says, God will wage war against Amalek with concealed hand. You can perceive that the concealed power of God was in Christ the crucified, before whom demons, and all the principalities and powers of the earth, tremble.